to Mr. Bob's Railroad Workbench, where we talk about math, science, history, and trains, and do it all with some fun activities. Welcome, I'm Mr. Bob, Bob Lettenberger, Education Director from the National Railroad Museum. If you are watching us live on Facebook and want to type in a question, well, feel free to do so. We'll answer those questions after the segment. If you'd like to type in and just let us know who you are and where you're watching from you as well, make sure also that you like the National Railroad Museum's Facebook page. Well, today we're going to go on a trip. We're going to travel on a passenger train, and we're going to find out who's on board to help you out as a passenger. You know, on a freight train, there's only a few people on board, but we as people when we travel need a lot more assistance. And, well, when we think about a passenger train, we probably recognize the conductor as one of the folks that works on board. He is the person who is in charge of the train. He's there to make sure that we are comfortable, that we are safe, that we have tickets, and that everything runs smoothly along our trip. We probably also have good visions of, well, the chef from the dining car preparing wonderful food for us. We've all probably heard about the legendary meals that can be had in a railroad dining car, and the chef in historic times was the one that took care of those, working some pretty long hours in some pretty tough conditions. But if we look at a passenger train, there's actually a lot more people that are working on it to make things go right for us as we travel. On Mr. Bob's Railroad Workbench, we have a passenger train set up, and let's see if we got all the people who would be working on the train. At the very front of our train, and usually on some of the best trains, the ones that traveled on the fastest schedules, we had a railroad post office car. Yes, a post office on a train on wheels. Mail was carried by rail from the 1800s through about 1970. And in this particular car, you would have anywhere from 7 to 14 postal agents locked inside, picking up the mail as they went along, sorting it, and then dropping it off at the appropriate cities. They were locked in that car because, well, the mail wasn't the only thing that was carried in a post office car. There was a lot of other valuables, say, large quantities of stamps that were actually worth money, were carried along, and so security was pretty important. Just like on a train today, or more so you might think of on an airplane today, you can check your baggage. And the baggage that's being checked from one big city to the next traveled in the baggage car, along with small parcels that were being shipped express by the railroads. In that baggage car, you'd have a baggage agent there to make sure that everything was organized, that the right bags were left off at the right cities, the right packages were delivered to the right stations as well. Next car on our train, we have a coach. Coach class, you got to sit in nice, comfortable chairs. They'd recline so you could sleep during the evening. Maybe it was a day coach for a train that didn't travel overnight. And a coach like this, you might encounter the conductor. You might also encounter his assistant, the train man or the brakeman. The train man was there to help the conductor, help with ticket taking, help making sure the train was operating smoothly according to the railroad's rules. On a coach car, you might also find, well, depending on the railroad and the time period, you might find a lady who would be there to assist passengers. In some cases, she was a nurse who was designing mothers with children that were traveling. If you were traveling on a railroad like the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy on one of their Zephyrs, they named those young ladies working in these cars the Zephyrettes. And they were very helpful to passengers during the heyday of passenger travel here in our country. Of course, as we travel along, we're probably going to get hungry, and that means next we're going to need to go to the dining car. As we mentioned, of course, the dining car has a chef, head chef. He would have 3 to 4 assistants, depending upon the size of the dining car and how many passengers were on board. The dining car is led by a gentleman named the steward. He was responsible for making sure that all supplies were on board, make sure that all the rules were being followed, make sure that proper service was being given. He handled any concerns from passengers. He was also responsible for all the dinner receipts. He had to account for all the money and make sure that it all tallied up properly at the end of the trip. Next in our train, we have a sleeping car. If you were traveling a longer distance overnight, you might be able to ride in a sleeping car where you actually would have a bed to lay down and snooze overnight. Well, in a sleeping car, you would have somebody called a porter who was there to take care of you. Now, originally, most sleeping cars were made by the Pullman Company, and they supplied their Pullman porters to go with the cars. Eventually, the railroads had their own porters, but the porter was there to make your bed, to carry your luggage, to shine your shoes, to take care of whatever you needed. He was your alarm clock. He'd make sure you got off at the right station. The porter was there to serve you and make sure that your trip was absolutely fantastic. And at the end of most big trains, most named trains, you'd find an observation car. A lot of them with a round end where you could sit by the windows and watch the scenery go by. In this car, if there were bedrooms, which there were in some, you'd find a porter. A lot of the lounge observation cars had a bar where you could get a drink along the way, and there you'd find a steward to take care of you and serve you your beverages. So a lot of different folks working on passenger trains, both today and historically. The railroads were very proud of their passenger service and the things that they would offer, especially on their top trains. And one example of that is in 1945, the New York Central issued an ad for their 20th Century Limited. The ad ran in several national magazines, and they pointed out all the different people that were there to make your trip on the 20th Century Limited top flight. Now, we mentioned a lot of the folks that you'd find working on the trains, but on some of the extra special trains like the 20th Century Limited, there were other people on board providing services unique to that train. On the 20th Century Limited, they also had on board a gentleman called the valet, who was there to press your pants for you, to make minor repairs to your clothing, a special service on a top train like the 20th Century Limited. Santa Fe, on their Super Chief, that name train traveling from Chicago to Los Angeles, in 1938, the Santa Fe issued an ad describing all the different services and people that worked on board the Super Chief to make things better. And one of the features that they had on the Super Chief was a barber shop. Yes, going across the West at 80 miles, they had a trained barber that could get you a haircut and a shave. Today, of course, on passenger trains, you'll find many people there to take care of you. The names are different, and of course, depending upon economic times and passenger loads, the number may be less than what it used to be historically. But there are still many, many good people traveling on trains today that are there to take care of you. Now, if you'd like to explore a little bit more about the people who work on passenger trains, go to our website, nationalrrmuseum.org, click on the Education tab and look for the Virtual Activity Zone. Look for today's episode of Mr. Bob's Railroad Workbench, and under there, there's an activity where you can help identify the crew on your passenger train. The National Railroad Museum inspires lifelong learning by providing dynamic educational opportunities through the preservation railroad objects, engaging exhibits, and innovative programs. As a nonprofit educational institution, we are supported by both public and private donations and our museum members. For more information on how you can help support the National Railroad Museum or to become a museum member, please visit our website, nationalrrmuseum.org. Thank you so much for all of your continued support. Hey, I'm Mr. Bob. Thanks for visiting Mr. Bob's Railroad Workbench, and we hope to see you here again real soon.